that which is expensive, hard to get to, and has more dire environmental consequences than all the oil, natural gas, and coal that we've managed to remove from the Earth so far. You all know this, right? You might know it, but you might not know it from any given second because you're focused on some other aspect of this horrible boondoggle, the eminent domain aspect, perhaps, the taking of land, which is supposed to be reserved for public use for the common good. And now we're talking about for profit-making entities, profit-making ventures. That is not the spirit of eminent domain, ladies and gentlemen. They're not building an airport. They're building a money machine. And they're also building a bridge to the last century when it comes to energy and technology. About 10 years ago, people started talking about something called peak oil. Peak oil simply means not necessarily that we're out of oil, but that we're out of the oil that is easy to get to and that worldwide production is going to start dropping, even with these bold and innovative approaches. Guess what, folks? We're there. We've hit the hump. We're not going to go up and hit another hump. We're on the downward slide. And this is just one symptom of that. You all probably know, but might not think of it at any given time, the destruction of the boreal forests resulting from the harvesting of tar sands up in northern Alberta. That in itself would be reason enough to stop this horrible project. But of course, you're not allowed to see that unless, you know, some left-wing Commie Pinko journalist went up in a helicopter and showed the before and after pictures. This is the forest still standing, and this is what's left over after they've gotten rid of all the trees and dug these huge, irreparable pits in the ground of the beautiful province of Alberta.
Hey, David, as you say, you can see it in maps.google.com, the port or the satellite views, as plain as can be.
It's on the web, it must be true, right? We knew about this in the 1970s, folks. I'm also showing my age, but in the 1970s, when high school students across the country debated comprehensive energy policy, we had a few cards in our card file about tar sand oil, or what they euphemistically like to call oil sands now. We could tell you that tar sands not only would ruin the boreal forests of Canada, but also would lead to global thermonuclear war. Because if you're going to talk about a disadvantage of anything, what's better than global thermonuclear war if you're arguing against it? Well, even worse than global thermonuclear war is global mass suicide without even bothering to send any nuclear missiles into the air. No less a scientist than Dr. James Hansen, who for decades has been the most respected climate scientist in this country by many measures, and plenty of climate scientists have independent research that confirms his conclusions. As we were saying earlier, the XL pipeline and the use of tar sand oil is what? Game over for the climate. It's not an energy future. It's an energy nowhere. It's world destruction. It is taking this number, 390 parts per million carbon dioxide in our atmosphere, and instead of stuffing it down back to that 350 level that Dr. Hansen recommends, accelerating the growth of CO2 concentration. It's going to get hotter, folks. The weather's going to get weirder and get nastier. And that forest up in Alberta is not going to be growing back anytime soon. You can't even go up there and plant a million trees and hope to recover what's going to be lost. This is a boondoggle from end to end. You know what? I bet President Barack Obama knows this. But President Barack Obama, the Democrat, does not have the cojones to face down, in spite of what he did earlier in the year, which was to put a hold on the pipeline. Then, of course, he does a little end-around run and okays the southern portion of the pipeline, connecting Oklahoma with our Gulf Coast here. He didn't have the cojones to go to Copenhagen in 2009 and call for bold, aggressive action against climate change. President Barack Obama is not our ally, ladies and gentlemen. We may be able to convince him otherwise. We may be able to put enough public pressure on him by circling the White House and chanting for days and days, chaining ourselves to the fence there until he finally says, "Uncle," but that's what it's going to take. I didn't say much about the Green Party just now, but just as a reminder, Jill Stein, our presidential candidate, not only opposes the Keystone XL pipeline and points out that it is not a long-term jobs program, as we all know, but she is also proposing the Green New Deal, investing in alternative energy sources and technologies, and the reparation of our infrastructure, and free post-secondary education for those who want and need it, putting 25 million Americans back to work in meaningful jobs that'll prepare us to face the 21st century and beyond. And that is not everything that Jill Stein stands for. I stand 100% behind the Green New Deal. I hope you will consider voting for Green candidates this November, especially in those races for Supreme Court and Railroad Commission. Remember, Railroad Commission does deal with what? Not railroads. Oil, gas, and pipelines, where there is no Democrat running. Vote for Charles Waterbury for State Supreme Court. Vote for Josh Wendell for Railroad Commission, even if you vote for no other Greens. But I would appreciate your vote for me, David Collins, for U.S. Senate this November. Are there any questions?